So I invite you to open your Bibles to the book of Genesis, chapter number 14, as we continue our study through the book of Genesis. Genesis, chapter number 14. I think that probably most of us are always fascinated and quite intrigued when great people meet. I can remember some of those famous meetings between President Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher and all the things that were accomplished through those meetings. And those of us that are interested in those kinds of things, we read the press reports and follow the news that are reporting on them. Probably all of us can remember reading our history books. Maybe some of you can remember you were well and active back during those days when there was that famous meeting between Joseph Stalin and FDR and Winston Churchill back in 1945, when the world obviously was at a crisis moment, and those three leaders got together, and that was an extremely important meeting. And yet, all of the meetings that we can think of that have occurred throughout history that have been fascinating and intriguing to us, I don't think are anything like the meeting that we're going to look at tonight between two great men that are found in the Bible. And one of these men we know a lot about, but the other guy we know very, very little about. But hopefully tonight, when we get to the end of the story, you'll know a lot more about him than you did when you came into the worship service tonight. But in Genesis chapter 14, and we're going to turn in a moment over to the book of Psalms and then to the book of Hebrews, because I want to read all the verses together that highlight what we're going to be looking at tonight. But in Genesis chapter 14, verse number 18, where we left off last Sunday night, it says that Melchizedek, now who in the world is that? If I were to ask you to stand up tonight, give me a 30-minute lecture on Melchizedek, what would you say? Well, probably not much. It says that Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine. He was the priest of the Most High God. And he blessed him, that is, he blessed Abram, and said, "Blessed be Abram of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be the Most High God, which hath delivered thine enemies into thy hand. And he that is Abram, he gave him, Melchizedek, tithes of all that he had." And then over in the book of Psalms, Psalm 110, we find him mentioned again. Psalm 110, he's mentioned in verse 4, but I want to read up in verse number 1, because this is actually one of those messianic psalms that is speaking of Jesus. And we cannot understand anything about Melchizedek if we don't understand something about the messianic psalm here. And it says in verse 1, this is David speaking, and David says, "The Lord," and the Lord that he's referring to there is God the Father. So God the Father, David said, "Said unto my Lord," that is God the Son, "Sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. The Lord shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion. Rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power, in the beauties of holiness, from the womb of the morning. Thou hast the dew of youth." Verse number 4, "The Lord hath sworn and will not repent or relent. Thou," that is God the Son, Jesus, "are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." And then the only other place where he is talked about is over in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 7. Now, you can lose your place there in Psalm 110, but you might want to hold your Bible open to Hebrews chapter 7, because we're going to be back there in just a little bit. But Hebrews chapter number 7. "For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abram," we just read about that in Genesis 14, "who met Abram returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abram gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation king of righteousness, and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace. He was without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abideth a priest continually." Now consider how great this man was. unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of his spoils. And verily, they that are of the sons of Levi, who receive the office of the priesthood, have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they came out of the loins of Abraham. But he whose descent is not counted from them received tithes of Abraham and blessed him that had the promises. And without all contradiction, the less, that's Abraham, is blessed by the better, that is Melchizedek. And here men that die receive tithes, but there he receiveth them of whom is witnessed that he liveth. And as I may say, Levi also who received tithes paid tithes in Abraham, for he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. Now verse 11 is real key. It says, if therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron or follow in the line of the Levitical priesthood? Now, when we put all of these verses together, I believe that there are two lessons that we learn. First of all, there's a very practical lesson. And then secondly, there is a theological lesson. And that's what I want us to look at tonight, that practical lesson and then the theological lesson. Some of you will remember back on June the 27th, 1976, when armed forces of what was known as the PFLP, that is the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, when they surprised 12 crew members of an Air France jetliner and its 91 passengers, hijacking that plane to an unknown destination. And the plane was tracked, obviously, and it was heading for Central Africa, where it landed under the approval of the then Ugandan president, Idi Amin. And there it remained, and apparently it seemed like it was secure at Entebbe Airport. And the hijackers spent the next 7 days preparing for what would be their next move. They appeared to be totally in control. It looked like there was no way that the hostages could be rescued. However, something was happening about 2,500 miles away that they had no idea was going on in a little place called Tel Aviv. Their Israeli C-130 Hercules transports were secretly boarded by a deadly force of Israeli commandos who, within hours, attacked the airport under the cover of darkness. And in less than 60 minutes, the commandos rushed to the old terminal, gunned down the hijackers, and rescued 110 of the 113 hostages. And the next day, July the 4th, Israel's premier, Yitzhak Rabin, triumphantly declared, and I quote his words, "This mission will become a legend." And surely it has. Israel's resolve and their stealth in liberating her people is admired by her friends and begrudged by her enemies. But did you know that that was not the first time that there had been a great rescue effort in the Middle East? In our last study, Sunday night a week ago, we read about another rescue that took place when four eastern kings that had put together this coalition came against five kings that lived in the Transjordan area, and they attacked those five cities, defeating the city-states of Sodom and their neighbors, carrying off tons of spoil, and most importantly, carrying off a great host of hostages. And one of those hostages, we learned, was Abram's nephew, a man by the name of Lot. And you will remember how the story went. Remember that Abram put together 318 trained men who were trained in the sword that was the Israeli commandos of that day. He led them. They went out and they defeated these four kings and their armies, and he rescued his nephew Lot along with the other hostages. And then the Bible says something very interesting. As they were making their way back home, Abram and his troops, they were met by this very strange guy that's pointed out in Scripture, this mysterious, shadowy figure, we might say, of immense grandeur, this guy by the name of Melchizedek, that the Bible says was the king priest of Salem, which was the old Jerusalem. And it's at that point where Abram and Melchizedek meet together that we have the story of what happens when great men meet. Now, there are the two things I want to notice, and the first one is just a very practical lesson. And there are several things about the practical lesson that I think that we learn from this story that we can apply to our lives tonight. First of all, the men. When we talk about these two men that were involved in this meeting, what do we know about them? Well, I could say right off the cuff that these two men obviously were great men. Now, there is no one here tonight that would argue that Abram was a great man. I mean, he occupies much of the space of the book of Genesis. In fact, we could say that Abram probably was the most important spiritual personality in the entire Old Testament. Abram, you will remember, was called the friend of God. He is the father of the faithful. He is most respected by the three great world religions of our day, Christianity, Islam, and Judaism. There are three key passages in the New Testament that highlight the greatness of Abram. One is Romans 4, the other is Galatians 3, the other is Hebrews chapter 11. And all of those highlight the greatness of Abram and what he is known most for, and that was his faith and his faithfulness to God. But what about Melchizedek? We don't know a whole lot about him, do we? As a matter of fact, only three verses in the book of Genesis refer to Melchizedek. And yet, 1,000 years later, Psalm 110, we read his story again. And then about 1,000 years later, which was Hebrews chapter 7, we read about him again. So how do we know then that this Melchizedek was such a great man? It's because of Hebrews chapter 7 and verse number 4 that says very clearly, consider how great this man was. In fact, he was so great that Hebrews 7 says he was greater than Abraham, because Abraham the lesser paid tithes to Melchizedek, who was the greater. And even Abraham recognized his greatness, because in Genesis 14 verse 20, we read where this man Melchizedek was paid tithes by Abram himself, and he recognized him as a priest of the Most High God. So that's the men. But secondly, the mystery. Now, friend, I can tell you there's a lot of stuff about Melchizedek that we'll never know. There are a lot of problems that are unsolvable. And I know that when you die and go to heaven, one of the first questions you're going to ask God is to share with me some information about Melchizedek. Pastor Connor preached about him. I don't know why he preached about him. I'll tell you why, because he's in the Bible. And he's in the next verses that we are going through. But it's extremely important that we understand a little bit about this man Melchizedek. But what about the mystery of this man? I would say, first of all, there is a mystery concerning his place. I mean, we open up Genesis 14, and there he is in Canaan. He is unexpected. He is unannounced, but he's there. I mean, how is it that a man like Melchizedek came to be in Canaan? Now, friend, if you know anything about your Bible history, you will know that the post-flood period was a time of rapid spiritual decay. It was not long after the flood until things started getting worse than they were before the flood. So how in the world did this guy, this great guy, get in the land of Canaan? As a matter of fact, the post-flood period in the land of Canaan, there were very few believers that were in that area. Abram was there, but we really don't know of any others, do we, that were there. In fact, Abram's immediate family, according to Joshua 24, verses 14 and 15, they were worshipers of false gods. And so there weren't many godly people that lived in Canaan that day. Up until now, there's absolutely no evidence that there was anyone other than Abram that was in Canaan that was a worshiper of the true God. Melchizedek was there. He worshiped God. How in the world did he get there? How did he come to understand and know about Yahweh, the one true God? How did all that come to pass? The bottom line is, we don't know. It was a mystery. So there is the mystery of his place. There is also the mystery of his priesthood. The Bible says he was a priest of the Most High God. Let me ask you, was it an official priesthood? We don't know. Was it recognized? And if so, by whom? We don't know. How did Abram know that he was a priest of the Most High God? Friends, we just don't know. It's a mystery. Thirdly, there is the mystery of his prominence. Now, I want to ask the question, if Melchizedek was as great as Hebrews chapter 7 verse 4 says that he is, if he was so great that Abram gave him tithes, if he was that great and that prominent, my question is, why didn't God choose Melchizedek instead of Abram to be the father of a new nation that one day would bring the Messiah into the world? Friend, I don't know. And the one thing to me that all of that points out, and all of this shrouded mystery that covers over Melchizedek, the one thing it points out to me is that our God is a sovereign God. And there are just some things about God we don't understand, can't understand, and never will understand. And it's the idea of God's sovereignty, of his being so far above us. That's one of the great things that inspires us, not all the things, but one of the things that inspires us to worship him. Because a God that we could truly, fully, completely understand would be a God who would be on our equal. And we only bow down and worship someone that's far above us. You know, it's kind of like Isaiah said over in Isaiah chapter 55 when he referred to God as the high and lofty one that inhabits eternity. In other words, God's so far above us out there that there are some things about him that we just will not understand. So we don't understand why God put Melchizedek there, how he got there. So many things we do not know about him. But friend, there's one thing we do know about him. Did you know that the word Melchizedek is not a personal name? In fact, it's a title. And the title is King of Righteousness. Now you see, we may not know what his personal name was. We may not know where he came from. We may not know who his mother and his father were. But there is one thing we do know. What do we know? He was a king of righteousness. What we do know is that he stood for righteousness in his day and his time. And should we not be able to say tonight that those of us who are identified with the God of the Bible should also be those who stand for righteousness? Now, friend, this is so significant when you consider the age in which Melchizedek lived. He lived among the Canaanites. What do we think of when we think of the Canaanites? I tell you what I think of. I think of despicable and corrupt worship. That's what I think of. I think of a kind of a religion that demands of its adherents that they sacrifice their sons and their daughters in the fire to appease their God. That's what I think of when I think about the Canaanite religion. I think about the vast cities of the plain there in Canaan when Abram first came along there. And I think about their promiscuity and their sexual perversion that was out in the open for all to see. That's what I think about. And I think that here, in the midst of all of that, stood Melchizedek, the king of righteousness, saying, I don't care what anybody else does, but as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord and we're going to stand for righteousness no matter how unrighteous the world may be around us. May his tribe increase. Now, dear friend, if that was said of Melchizedek, should it not be said of you and I as well? No wonder the Bible calls him great. You know, God considers greatness much differently than the world does. Friend, our greatness is not determined by our wealth, by our degrees, or by our pedigree. Our greatness is determined in the eyes of God by whether or not we stand for righteousness. And you know, should not we do the same thing? 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5 and verse 9 says that we are a chosen generation and a royal what? Priesthood. So if this priest stood for righteousness, then we as New Testament priests, we ought to stand for righteousness as well. Don't you get a little sick and tired of the wishy-washiness you see amongst Christians today that just absolutely won't stand for anything and just compromise on everything and pretty much water down everything? I think it would be refreshing to see a group of believers in loving kindness and grace who took their stand in righteousness and said, like the great Martin Luther, "I can take no other stand." That's the kind of guy I think that Melchizedek was. I used to say, when I grow up, I want to be like Paul. Well, I think when I grow up, I want to be like Melchizedek, this king of righteousness. But there's a third thing that we see, and that is the meeting. Now, this meeting that occurred back in Genesis chapter 14, verse number 18 through 20, it's really fascinating when you look at it, because when we think of the meeting of great people, what is usually the first thing that they try to do? If the president of one country sits down with the president of another country, what is usually the first thing that they do? They try to outdo each other. Why do they do that? So they can establish and enhance their own reputation, so that they can make themselves look good and respectable in the eyes of the world. But did you notice that Melchizedek and Abram, these two great men that had that meeting, they didn't do that. In fact, they supported and they encouraged one another. Man, I want to tell you, if that meeting would have taken place in our day and time, there would have been a lot of fleshly competition going on between these two guys. But you want to know why that didn't describe them? Because they were both servants of the Most High God. And what was important to them was not their glory, it was God's glory. So when these two men got together, they could care less about building themselves up, because the most important thing to them was to be a servant of the Most High God. Absolutely no competition. Friend, I would not have believed what I'm about to tell you that I heard had I not heard it with my own ears. Someone told me a while back, they said, you need to go online, you need to look up this certain church online, and you need to listen to this sermon that was preached by a local pastor. And I said, well, why do I need to do that? They said, you just need to do that. So I went online, something I very seldom do. I just don't listen to other pastors preaching. Maybe I should. Maybe it would help me. So I went online, and I tuned this guy in. And while he was preaching, he made this statement. And man, he just had them in an uproar. And he said, we are going to be bigger than that church downtown. We're going to grow and we're going to get so large that we're going to be larger than that First Baptist Church downtown. And when I first heard that, my first thought was how grieving that must be to the heart of God. You see, we're not in competition, are we? We're not in competition with some other church. I certainly am not in competition with some other pastor. I mean, the last I checked, there are plenty of lost people in Bay County for every church to reach. But this old competitive spirit, if we're going to be bigger than them and we're going to be larger than them and we're going to have a name that's greater than them, I want to tell you what, that is not of God. That is of the flesh, isn't it? And you see, you didn't see any of that between these two great men because these two great men were servants of the Most High God, and they cared only about His glory. They didn't care about their own. So that's the practical lesson that we learn. But secondly, and most importantly, is the theological lesson that we learn. And the theological lesson that we learn is pointed out over in the book of Hebrews. So just go there and camp out with me for a few moments in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 7. Now, let me tell you what we do know about Melchizedek. It says he didn't have a mother or a father. He had no beginning or ending. There are no genealogical records there to identify him. And so that's led to a lot of speculation. A lot of people believe that he was a manifestation of the pre-incarnate Christ, but that cannot be so because he was a type or a picture of Christ according to Psalms 110. There are those, Martin Luther said that he was Shem, but that cannot be because we know the genealogy of Shem. So what can we say about Melchizedek? We can say that he was a very real, literal person, just as real and alive as you and I, who was a type or a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. We can also say that he had a priesthood that predated the Levitical priesthood. And that's extremely important when you get to Hebrews chapter number 7, because the whole point of Hebrews chapter 7 is pointing out to the Hebrew believers that the sacrifice of Jesus Christ was superior to the sacrifices of the Levitical priesthood. Now, how do we know that? Because down in verse number 11 of Hebrews chapter 7, it says, "If therefore perfection came by the Levitical priesthood," that is by the sacrifices that they offered, "if that's the way that it came, what further need was there that another priest should arise after the order of Melchizedek?" That was Jesus, according to Psalm 110, verse number 4. So the whole point was that the writer of Hebrews, whoever that was trying to get across to the Hebrew Christians, was that the sacrifice of Christ, far superior to any sacrifices that could be made by the Levitical priesthood in reference to sin. And the reason that we know that is because Jesus, His priesthood did not come from the order of Aaron and the Levitical priesthood, but it came from the order of a priesthood that predated the Levitical priesthood, and that was the priesthood of Melchizedek. And that is what made his sacrifice far superior than the Levitical priesthood sacrifices. And that, in a nutshell, is exactly what was being communicated here to these Hebrew Christians. And so then, if that's the case, and if Melchizedek is a type of Christ that paints us a picture of Christ, then when we read Melchizedek's story in Hebrews chapter 7, it gives us a beautiful picture then of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's what I want to show you in the remainder of our time in Hebrews chapter 7. So what do we learn about Jesus from reading the story of Melchizedek? The first thing that we learn is found in verse number 1 of Hebrews 7, and that is that the Lord Jesus is a universal Savior. A universal Savior. How do we know that? He says, "Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God." Did you know that in relation to Israel, that God chose the name Yahweh or Jehovah? And so all of those that were descendants of Aaron that served in the Levitical priesthood, they served Yahweh, and the way they served Yahweh, listen carefully, was by ministering only to the people of Israel. They did not minister to the Gentiles. So that priesthood was narrow. It was confined. It was not a universal priesthood. But you see, the priesthood of Melchizedek was universal because he was the priest of what? The Most High God. And that is the name for God. Listen, El Elyon. And the name El Elyon has a wider scope than the name Yahweh. The name El Elyon refers to God, who is a universal God. A God who is the possessor of heaven and earth. A God who is God both of the Jews and the Gentiles. That could not be said in relation to the Levitical priesthood. And the whole point, friend, is that Jesus Christ is not simply the Lord of the Jews, he is the Lord of the Gentiles as well. In fact, he is not just the Lord of the Jews and the Gentiles, he is the Lord of the whole world. Over in Philippians chapter 2, it says that God highly exalted him and gave him a name that was above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Of what? He is Lord of all. And so that idea of the Most High God then just paints us the picture that Jesus is a universal Savior, not of a particular race, but of everybody. You think that's why when the angel announced the birth of Jesus, that the angel said, I give you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to what? All people. See, that is why we are interested in and involved in global missions. Because Jesus isn't just Lord of the folks in Bay County. He's Lord of the folks in Brazil, and he's Lord of the folks in Venezuela. And he's Lord of everybody. And he wants everybody to hear the message of the good news of the gospel. So he is a universal Savior. That's what we learn by looking at Melchizedek. He is also a royal Savior. I love verses 1 and 2. For this Melchizedek, mark this, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abram returning from the slaughter of the kings. Verse 2, to whom also Abram gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation king of righteousness, after that king of Salem, which is king of peace. Four times in two verses, Melchizedek is referred to as king. Four times he's called a king. And when we look at the universal priesthood and the royal office of Melchizedek, it points out to us the saviorhood and lordship of Jesus Christ. Gloriously, Jesus is our Savior. But friend, there's more. He's our Lord and Savior. And I know that this may be, you know, just a semantic issue, but I really don't like it when I hear someone talking about making Jesus Lord. That's ridiculous. That's like I'm saying I'm making my truck a Dodge pickup. Friend, he is Lord. We don't make him Lord. When we trust him as our Savior, we trust him as our Lord, right? I know what people are saying. People are saying that, you know, when I first got saved, I didn't understand all there was to understand. And by the way, we'll never understand all there is to understand about the areas of our lives that need to be surrendered to the Lordship of Christ. And so there came a time when I understood that, and that day I made Jesus the Lord of my life. No, you didn't. No, you didn't. He was Lord long before you supposedly made him Lord. You see, when we come to the Lord Jesus to be saved, the only way to be saved is to yield to him what we know as the Lord of our life, right? Because we can't come to him trusting him as our Savior while living in a spirit of rebellion at the same time. It doesn't work that way. So the moment that we come to him, he reveals to us areas of our lives that we need to surrender, and we do so. Why? Because he's Lord. You look at all the salvific passages in the New Testament that talks about Jesus saving us. And what you will see is that the Saviorhood of Jesus and the Lordship of Jesus are always connected. Whosoever believes on the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. You know, when we confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in our hearts that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So when we come to Christ to be our Savior, he's not just an addition to our life. He becomes our life. Because not only is he our Savior, he is our Lord. You can't separate Jesus' lordship from his Saviorhood. And I believe the universal priesthood and his royalty here of Melchizedek so clearly points that out. You see, we know that Jesus is Lord when we look at the life of Melchizedek, because just like Melchizedek, Jesus is king. The Bible says he was born as a king. In Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, what does the Bible say? Wise men came from the east heading to Jerusalem in search for the one that was born king of the Jews. The Bible says he lived as a king. In John chapter 12, verse number 13, when Jesus rode into Jerusalem in his triumphal entry on the back of a donkey, the people waved the palm branches and cried out, "Hosanna," and said, "Blessed is the King of Israel who comes in the name of the Lord." Friend, not only did he live as a king, was he born as a king, but he died as a king. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 37, the Bible says when he died, there was a placard over his head that read, "This is the King of the Jews." And can I tell you that when he returns, he will return as a king. Because Revelation 19, verse 16 says that when he returns, there will be a name written on his vesture and on his thigh that says, "King of Kings and Lord of Lords." He is not simply some Savior who died who could not help himself. He's King of Kings and he is Lord of Lords. And that's why Melchizedek is such a wonderful picture of him. I would say thirdly that by looking at Melchizedek, we see that he is a sufficient Savior. Because I like it, verse 2 refers to Melchizedek as a king of righteousness. And also in the latter part of that verse, he is a king of peace. Sufficient because he brings righteousness and he also brings peace. Did you know that the purpose of the Levitical priesthood was never to obtain a permanent righteousness and a permanent peace, because the Levitical priesthood could not do that? All it could do was cover up sin until the only one who could came to take away our sins. And there cannot be permanent righteousness and peace until our sins are taken away. So it's only in Christ that we have both righteousness and peace permanently. I think this order here is divinely inspired by the Spirit of God. Righteousness, then peace. Did you notice it? There's righteousness and then there's peace. There is not peace before there is righteousness. Before we are declared righteous through the blood of Jesus Christ, there will never be any peace. You know, when these Old Testament believers, when they went to the Day of Atonement and a sacrifice was made, the peace lasted only as long as they did not sin. But once they sinned again, their peace was removed and they had no peace. And only when the one who came, who could take our sins away and declare us righteous permanently, then was peace actually given. Friend, I can't explain it and neither can you, but your experience is the same as mine. All I know is that day when I gave my hand to the preacher and my heart to Jesus, and God declared me righteous, God delivered unto me peace. And it's been there ever since. First comes the righteousness, then comes the peace. Have you ever noticed how many times, in the New Testament, when Jesus would physically heal somebody, he would always give this phrase, "Go in peace, go in peace, go in peace, go in peace." Why is that? Because every physical healing in the Bible by Jesus is a picture of the healing of the soul that comes through an experience of salvation. And Jesus says to us, once we are saved, what does he say? Go in peace. Thank you, Brother Ken, for singing tonight about the cross, because the cross is the only place, it really is, where we find any peace. I love that old hymn, I saw the cross of Jesus when burdened with my sin. I sought the cross of Jesus to give me peace within. I brought my soul to Jesus. He cleansed it in his blood. And in the cross of Jesus, I found my peace with God. I was so ignorant, looking for this peace for so long, in so many places and in so many different experiences. And friend, I tell you, when I came to the cross of Christ, I said, this is it. And the burden of sin was gone away, and the peace of God filled my heart. And dear friend, it filled it to stay. Can I get a witness? Doesn't ebb and flow, it comes to stay. And there's one final thing here. When we look at Melchizedek, it tells us that Jesus is a unique Savior. Because in verse number 3, it says that he was without father and without mother. I'd say that was unique. Now, that does not mean that Melchizedek didn't have a mother or father. It just means we don't know who they were. Was Jesus unique as far as relating to his parents? I would say so. He had an earthly mother, didn't he? But he had a heavenly father. And did you know that when Jesus was born, that Jesus at his birth was older than his earthly mother and just as old as his heavenly father? I'd say that's pretty unique, wouldn't you? Said that Melchizedek had neither beginning of days nor end of life, made like unto the Son of God. Now, friend, what does that speak of? That speaks of our Lord Jesus' eternality. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. It means that we can't go anywhere in the past where he wasn't. It means that we can never get ahead of him in the future. He's the beginning and he is the end. See, that's the picture of Jesus that we get by looking at Melchizedek. Friend, every time we speak the blessed name Jesus, something sweet ought to well up in our hearts. Is there any name like Jesus? There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. His music's in the sinner's ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. Friend, every time we speak the name Jesus, let us be reminded of what a holy name that we are speaking. What a precious Savior he is. What a special Savior he is. What a unique Savior that he is. May we treat him as the one that he is. I remember one time being at a Southern Baptist convention, listening to Dr. W.A. Criswell preaching. And Dr. Criswell, when he concluded his message on Jesus, he shared that he'd had a dream just a few nights earlier. And he said, in that dream, I saw the Savior. I saw his bare back as soldiers were lifting up the cat of nine tails to bring them down upon his back. He said, in my dream, I rose up and I reached out and I grasped the arm of the soldier that was beating the back of my Savior. And when I turned him around, I recognized it was me. It was me. You see, the amazing thing about Jesus is that we are the ones who crucified him. We spit in his face. We put a crown of thorns on him. We beat him unmercifully. We picked up the hammer and we drove the spikes in his feet and in his hands. And yet God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, he died for us. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Would you stand, please? And I'm going to pray and we'll be dismissed. Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for this man in Scripture we fully can't understand who points us to Jesus, shows us who he is. God, I pray that we would think about just the things that we've talked about tonight concerning the Lord Jesus as being the universal Savior and the royal Savior, the sufficient Savior, the unique Savior. And every time we speak the name Jesus, let us say, thank God that I've been given the ability to speak that name. Not only to speak that name, but to know him in a personal way. And I pray that you would send us out into this community this week with a burden on our hearts that there are so many all around us that Jesus isn't precious to, and give us an opportunity to tell them about the hope that dwells in us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You're dismissed.